everybody. My name is Bart Charles Begley, or BC Begley. Today is Thursday, February the 16th, 2023, and here are your news headlines for today. Okay, let's go to Georgia, where Trump grand jury recommends perjury indictments in probe of 2020 Georgia election meddling. A Georgia special grand jury concluded that one or more witnesses in a probe into possible election meddling by former United States President Donald Trump may have lied under oath and recommended a prosecutor pursue criminal indictments in those cases. The grand jury also said in its final report on its months-long investigation that it found no significant fraud in Georgia's 2020 presidential election, which was won by current President Joe Biden. But the panel's conclusions on whether Trump or any of his lawyers and political allies broke the law in pressuring Georgia officials to overturn the election in his favor were not released Thursday as part of the sections of the report unsealed by a Fulton County Superior Court judge. Among other actions, the grand jury that was impaneled in May was known to be eyeing a January 2nd, 2021 phone call by then-President Trump in which he urged Georgia Secretary of State Brad Raffensperger to, quote, find 11,780 votes for him. That number of votes would have given former President Trump enough to win the state of Georgia and its 16 Electoral College votes. Those sealed sections are expected to become public at some future date. Fulton County District Attorney Fannie Willis will determine whether to charge former President Trump or anyone else in this case. The re-election bid looms. President Joe Biden, who is 80 years old, undergoes physical examination. United States President Joe Biden, who is 80 years old, headed into a closely watched physical examination on Thursday morning ahead of an expected announcement that he is seeking a second four-year term. President Biden's session with the doctors at Walter Reed National Military Medical Center in Washington, suburb of Bethesda, Maryland, was his second extensive exam since taking office in January of 2021. President Biden entered the hospital for an exam expected to last about 3 hours. The White House was expected to release details of the exam's findings later on Thursday. His last physical and colonoscopy back in November 2021 showed the president to be a, quote, healthy, vigorous 78-year-old male, his doctors said at the time. He had a polyp removed from his colon and his contact lens prescription was updated, their six-page memo noted. President Biden is the oldest person ever to serve as U.S. president. He has often waved off questions about his age. With President Biden expected to launch his re-election presidential campaign in the near future, current polls indicate that voters have some concerns about his ability to serve four more years if he were to win in 2024. Vice President Mike Pence says he will fight subpoena as far as the Supreme Court. Former Vice President Mike Pence said Wednesday that he will challenge a subpoena by the special counsel overseeing former President Donald Trump's investigations to compel his testimony before a grand jury, who is pursuing it to the Supreme Court if necessary. Special Counsel Jack Smith, appointed by the Justice Department, is currently investigating efforts by former President Donald Trump and his allies to overturn the results of the 2020 presidential election. Former President Trump spent the days before January 6, 2021, aggressively pressuring former Vice President Pence to reject the outcome of the election, even though former Vice President Pence had no power to do so. Pence was at the United States Capitol presiding over a joint session of Congress as Trump supporters protested and then stormed into the Capitol building later on that day. Quote, let me be first clear. I'm going to fight the Biden DOJ subpoena for me to appear before the grand jury because I believe it's unconstitutional and it's unprecedented, Pence told reporters in Iowa, the state that will hold the first contest of the 2024 nominating sequence. Quote, never before in American history has a vice president been summoned to appear in court to testify against the president with whom they serve, he said. Pence said he was prepared to take the case, quote, as far as it needs to go, if it needs to be the Supreme Court of the United States. Mark Meadows, former President Donald Trump's last chief of staff, has been subpoenaed by a grand jury. Former White House Chief of Staff Mark Meadows has been subpoenaed by the special counsel investigating former President Donald Trump's efforts to overturn his loss in the 2020 election, according to a person familiar with the matter. Mr. Meadows received the subpoena in late January, the person said, as special counsel Jack Smith's investigation escalated his probe into steps Mr. Trump and his allies took to keep him from office. As former President Trump's final White House chief of staff, Meadows would be among the closest advisors of the former president to be summoned before the grand jury. The demand for his testimony predated a separate subpoena issued to former Vice President Mike Pence as part of the investigation. The two top aides to Mr. Pence, his former chief of staff Mark Short and counsel Greg Jacob, are among the former Trump administration officials who have already appeared before the grand jury. The subpoena for Meadows could set the stage for further court battles between prosecutors and former President Trump, whose lawyers have cited executive privilege in attempts to block or delay the testimony of top aides in investigations examining the former president. Former Vice President Pence plans to resist his subpoena by arguing that, as vice president, he served also as president of the Senate and is covered by the Constitution's speech or debate clause, which protects members of Congress from being questioned in court about legislative acts. Carrie Lake's lawyers have been hit with bar complaints. A legal group plans to file bar complaints Thursday against four lawyers representing Carrie Lake in voter fraud litigation, NBC News has learned. Lake, a Donald Trump acolyte, who has refused to accept that she lost the governor's race in Arizona last year, campaigned on the voter fraud claims first popularized by the former president. She filed lawsuits before and after the election advancing the claims. A federal judge, though, has already sanctioned her lawyers for their efforts, but they could soon face suspensions or even disbarment. The 65 Project, which is a group targeting attorneys who advance election fraud claims in court, said they are filing bar complaints in Minnesota and Maryland against attorneys Jesse Kilbort, Joseph Poole, and Andrew Parker, who are licensed to practice law in Minnesota, and Kurt Olson, who is licensed in Maryland. They did not immediately respond to request for comment. The four lawyers represented Lake and Mark Finchin, then a Republican candidate for Secretary of State in Arizona, in a lawsuit first filed back in April challenging the use of electronic voting machines. Footage from Tijuana is pouring through San Diego border canyons after recent pipe break. Millions of gallons of raw sewage from Mexico are currently gushing into San Diego through two canyons along the border. This is according to federal officials. The spill is coming from at least two pump stations that were forced to shut down after a construction crew last week inadvertently ruptured a major pipeline south of Tijuana. Shorelines as far north as the Silver Strand were closed due to sewage contamination as of Wednesday, with the rest of the region's coastline under the standard 72-hour rain advisory. South Bay beaches have been repeatedly shuttered as a result of winter storms that washed polluted flows through the Tijuana River watershed. Quote, I've said it 1,000 times, but I'll keep saying it until it's fixed. It's an environmental injustice, said Imperial Beach Mayor Paloma Aguilar, who has made cleaning up pollution from Tijuana her top priority in her city. The recent spill, which started last Friday, is concentrated in Goat Canyon and Smuggler's Gulch, where concentrate capture basins are helping to redirect some of the flow to the South Bay International Wastewater Treatment Plant,
along the border in San Diego, officials have said.
Man was killed by his own aggressive pet rooster.
The daughter of a man who was killed by his pet rooster is warning of the dangers of aggressive poultry after the bird also attacked her young child. Jasper Krause, 67, suffered a heart attack after the bird plunged its spur into his leg, causing him to lose liters of blood. Wow. Daughter Virginia Gunnan, 33, says Jasper, who is a dad of two and a granddad of two, was an experienced animal handler, and while attacks are rare, warned others to watch out for signs of aggression. Trainee healthcare assistant Virginia from South Roscommon, Ireland, said, quote, "You wouldn't think a chicken can be dangerous, but they can be. Quote, it was a malicious attack, absolutely brutal. There are liters of blood all over the floor when I arrived. Quote, this particular bird was thought to be a nice and docile breed and good for children, but this shows any breed can be dangerous. Quote, having pet chickens is a big thing for families now, especially getting children involved. For this to happen is so rare and unbelievable, but it can happen," she said. Retired horse trainer Jasper was out in his garden on April 28th last year when the rooster attacked him from behind. He lost so much blood that it caused a secondary heart attack, and then he passed away about an hour later. Now Virginia is warning of the dangers of owning poultry, encouraging owners to watch out for signs of rooster aggression.
American pastor says sermons written by ChatGPT will have no soul.
Among sermon writers, there is fascination and unease over the fast-expanding abilities of artificial intelligence chatbots. For now, the evolving consensus among clergy is this. Yes, they can write a passably competent sermon, but no, they can't replicate the passion of actual preaching. Quote, it lacks a soul. I don't know how else to say it, said Herschel York, a pastor in Kentucky who is also dean of the School of Theology and a professor of Christian preaching at the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. Sermons are meant to be the core of a worship service, and often are faith leaders' best weekly shot at grabbing the congregation's attention to impart theological and moral guidance. Lazy pastors might be tempted to use artificial intelligence for this purpose, York said, quote, but not the great shepherds, the ones who love preaching, who love their people. A rabbi in New York named Joshua Franklin recently told his congregation at the Jewish Center of the Hamptons that he was going to deliver a plagiarized sermon dealing with such issues as trust, vulnerability, and forgiveness. Upon finishing, he asked the worshipers to guess who wrote it. When they appeared stumped, he revealed that the writer was ChatGPT, responding to his request to write a 1,000-word sermon related to that week's lesson from the Torah.
Oldest complete Hebrew Bible is expected to break records at auction.
The earliest and most complete Hebrew Bible ever discovered, quote, a vital touchstone of human history that dates back more than 1,100 years, is to be sold at an auction. The 9th century volume, referred to as the Codex Sassoon, is a critical link between the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Bible of today. It is being offered by Salisbury with an estimate of $30 million to $50 million, making it the most valuable historical document or manuscript ever to appear at auction. Composed of 24 books that are divided into three parts, the Pentateuch, the Prophets, and the Writings, the Hebrew Bible is the foundation of Judaism and other Abrahamic faiths. In Christianity, the texts are referred to as the Old Testament and are incorporated into the biblical canon. Islam also holds the series of the Hebrew Bible in special regard, with many of them included in the Quran and other significant works of Islamic literature. Before the first codexes, manuscripts in a book form of the Hebrew Bible, there existed only portions or sections of biblical text in scroll form. Known as the Dead Sea Scrolls, they date to the 3rd century BC, but they were copied without punctuation or vocalization and contained no verses or chapters. This meant the correct reading of the scrolls was not easily apparent. Instead, Jews in antiquity relied on inherited oral traditions to understand, preserve, and transmit the words of the Hebrew Bible. The Codex Sassoon is named after its prominent modern owner, David Solomon Sassoon, who lived between 1880 and 1942. He assembled the most significant private collection of Jewish artifacts and Hebrew manuscripts in the world. It comes to auction from the collection of Jacques Safra and will be sold in New York this May. The record for the most valuable historical text and manuscript sold at auction is held by the first printing of the U.S. Constitution, which sold for $43 million in November of 2021.
Scientists detect signs of hidden structure inside of the Earth's core.
While most of us take the ground beneath our feet for granted, written within a complex layers like pages of a book is Earth's history, which is our history. Research shows there are little known chapters in that history, deep within Earth's past. In fact, Earth's inner core appears to have another even more inner core within it. Quote, traditionally, we've been taught the Earth has four main layers, the crust, the mantle, the outer core, and the inner core. Australian National University geophysicist Joanne Stevenson explained back in 2021. Our knowledge of what lies beneath Earth's crust has been inferred mostly from what volcanoes have divulged and what seismic waves have whispered. From these indirect observations, scientists have calculated that the scorchingly hot inner core, with temperatures surpassing 5,000 degrees Celsius or 9,000 degrees Fahrenheit, makes up only 1% of Earth's total volume. But a few years ago, Stevenson and colleagues found evidence that Earth's inner core may actually have two distinct layers. Quote, it's very exciting and might mean that we might have to rewrite the textbooks, Stevenson explained at the time.
Elusive Planet 9 could be surrounded by hot moons, and that's how we'd find it.
The elusive Planet 9, which may or may not lurk in the outer reaches of our solar system, could be surrounded by a small swarm of potential moons, a new study is revealing. What's more, these moons could be the key to finding the missing planet. Planet 9, if it exists, lurks beyond the orbit of Neptune in an icy region known as the Kuiper Belt. Scientists first proposed the existence of Planet 9 back in a 2016 study in the Astronomical Journal. They used the hypothetical planet as a possible explanation for the unusual orbits of several extreme trans-Neptune objects, asteroids, comets, moons, or dwarf planets that are beyond 30 astronomical units from the Sun. Researchers think the trajectory of these ETNOs can be best explained by the gravitational force of an undiscovered mass. Based on these orbits, Planet 9 is likely between 5 and 10 times larger than Earth and orbits the Sun from around 250 times farther away than our planet does. There have even been suggestions that the elusive object could be a mini black hole. So far, scientists searching in the area haven't found any light signatures from Planet 9, but that's not surprising. The planet is too far away to be properly illuminated by the Sun, so the only way to spot it would be if it eclipsed a distant light source, such as a galaxy or star within the Milky Way.
All right, an update on the Ohio train derailment. East Palestine mayor says he needs help ahead of the EPA administrator's visit.
The mayor of an Ohio village where a train carrying toxic chemicals derailed earlier this month has told ABC News that he, quote, wasn't built for this, and needs help. East Palestine Mayor Trent Conaway briefly spoke to reporters on Wednesday evening before a town hall meeting with residents in the local high school's gymnasium. ABC News asked Conaway about the pressure of being in the national spotlight and whether he has a message for U.S. Environmental Protection Agency Administrator Michael Regan, who is slated to visit on Thursday. Quote, I need help, the mayor responded. I'm not ready for this. I wasn't built for this. I always thought of myself as a leader. I will do whatever it takes. Earlier Wednesday, Regan announced via Twitter that he will travel to the village in northeastern Ohio to visit the derailment site, hear from impacted residents, and meet with the state's emergency responders. Quote, I want the residents of East Palestine to know that we understand their fears and concerns, Regan tweeted. Quote, we are going to get through this together, and we are holding Norfolk Southern accountable.
Is warning the United States against escalation as the balloon saga spirals.
China on Thursday accused the United States of escalating the dispute over the downed surveillance balloon, as concerns grew that the saga may send relations between the world's two largest economies further into a tailspin. The episode and the mystery surrounding subsequent aerial objects that have been shot down over North America have fueled a domestic media frenzy and piled on political pressure on the White House, but also intensified concerns about the global fallout from the United States-China diplomacy being kind of knocked off course. As President Joe Biden prepared to give his most extensive remarks yet on the matter, Beijing hit back anew over what it has framed as Washington's overreaction. But the response has also undermined China's recent efforts to signal a diplomatic softening.
Peru's Machu Picchu reopens after being closed following protest.
Peru's Machu Picchu, an Inca-era stone citadel that's nestled in its southeastern jungle, reopened on Wednesday after being closed nearly a month ago amid anti-government protest, the culture ministry announced. Agreements were made between authorities, social groups, and the local tourism industry to guarantee the security of the famed tourist attraction and the transport services. Protest calling for the resignation of President Dina Boluarte and members of Peru's Congress have shaken the region, including Cusco, for more than 2 months. The demonstrations caused a blockade of the train tracks that led to the stone citadel. The protests have led to 60 deaths, 48 of which have been civilians who died in clashes with the security forces. 11 civilians were killed in traffic accidents related to road blockades, and one policeman died inside a patrol car when it was set on fire, according to data from the Ombudsman's office.
NATO's chief urges Turkey to let the Nordic pair of countries join the alliance quickly.
NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg on Thursday urged Turkey to ratify the applications of Finland and Sweden to join the military organization, repeating his claim that the Nordic neighbors have done enough to satisfy Ankara's demands and that they cracked down on extremism. At a news conference in Ankara, standing alongside Turkish Foreign Minister, Stoltenberg also condemned the burning of the Muslim holy book, the Quran, at a protest in Sweden, but he said that this is not illegal in Europe. Alarmed by Russia's invasion of Ukraine a year ago, Finland and neighboring Sweden abandoned decades of non-alignment and applied to join the alliance. All 30 NATO members must approve their applications, and 28 have ratified their accession. Only Turkey and Hungary have failed to do so. Stoltenberg and most allies have long said that both Nordic neighbors should join at the same time, but in recent days, NATO's top civilian official has softened his stance amid Turkey's reluctance to ratify Sweden's accession.
United States Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin says the U.S. would enter conflict if Russia attacks Estonia.
In the event that Russia launches an attack or an invasion against Estonia, the United States will enter the conflict, according to the head of the Department of Defense for the United States. Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin III spoke Thursday at a meeting of NATO defense ministers in Brussels, Belgium. The conference focused heavily on the Russian invasion of Ukraine, which is approaching its one-year anniversary. Austin was asked by a reporter how the country could be confident they'd have the backing of U.S. military in the event of a Russian invasion. Quote, you know, I'll just point to what our president, President Biden, has said a number of times, And what I've also said, our commitment to Article 5 is ironclad, and we take that very seriously, and we live up to our commitments, Austin told the press. Article 5 of NATO's Washington Treaty is known as the Principle of Collective Defense. It obliges all member countries to come to the aid of another member whose sovereignty or territorial integrity might come under threat. NATO defines it as being, quote, at the very heart of NATO's founding treaty.
Large pet emu runs loose through the streets of South Boston, Massachusetts.
A large pet bird that is normally native to Australia caused a ruckus south of Boston, Massachusetts, after escaping from her home, the AP reported. The bird is an emu. It's the second tallest bird on Earth after the ostrich, which is its close relative. The flightless bird apparently managed to get loose on Thursday night in East Bridgewater and led police on a chase through Brockton, WCVB-TV reported. East Bridgewater is located about 25 miles south of Boston. Surveillance video showed the emu strolling through an intersection in Brockton, Massachusetts, which is about 20 miles south of Boston. A different video posted on social media then showed her running alongside a car, various news outlets also reported. The bird's owner, Lee Flattery, told the television station that a wild animal likely caused the emu to jump over a 6-foot-high fence and take off. The pet bird, which is named Mallory, eventually was subdued in a parking lot by Flattery, the police, and a helpful local bystander, the Associated Press reported.
Hello, everybody. Okay, thank you so much for watching. As always, all of the articles that I have covered in this video, I will put links to in the video's description. Don't forget to like and subscribe and share. Also, if you want, you can leave a comment down below. If you guys want more news, you can visit my website at bcbegley.com. And I will see you guys for even more news headlines tomorrow.